Church Lavington presents How to Conquer Unbelief by Pastor James Okumu.
Let's shout because we know He lives and we answer. His love has set us free. The enemy is defeated. Sickness is defeated. Poverty is defeated.
Kaukwa, sahani, giza, kiboko. Yeah, I can tell how old you are. Those who have no clue, nini wa a few years ago. But anyway, there was this man who was a Christian and God had privileged him. And he had a very large company that he was running and he had employed quite a number of people. Now, most of the people that he had employed were people from the lower class in society. And so, every now and then, they would go to him to ask for money. You know, nipatie loan. You know, loan ya salo. And he had lended quite a number of people in his organization some money. And he was wondering how he could minister to them being a Christian. How can I get these people, you know, to begin to love God, to begin to follow God's ways, because I know God wants to prosper them. And then one day God gave him an idea. And so he wrote a very big notice and he put it on the notice board. And it simply said, Thursday, between 11 and midday, anyone who comes to my office to present an honest account of how much they owe me, they will have their debts canceled. And that whole week, people in the office were talking all sorts of things, saying all sorts of things. Thursday came. 11 o'clock, and almost everybody was gathered outside, and no one was going in, and they were just chatting and talking about this boss. Could it be true? You know, he wants to trap us. You know, he wants to do this. This thing is not good. Don't go in there. And they talked and they talked and they talked. You know how we are. And then at 11:45, 15 minutes to midday, one guy gathered courage. And he walked into the boss's office. And the boss said, why are you here? And he said, I read your notice and you said, anyone who comes to present an honest account of their debts, they will be forgiven. And the boss asked, do you believe that? And he said, yes, I do. Why do you believe that? And he said, well, because I know you are a good man and you would not mislead us in any way. So here is how much I owe you. And the boss took it and stamped paid in full. And the guy was, he was happy. And he started saying, I told them it is true. I told them it's true. Let me run outside and tell them it is true. But the boss said, wait. It's not yet 12 o'clock. Why should they get an extra privilege to believe that it is true and you didn't get it? So stay with me. And he stayed with the boss until 12 midday, then he walked out with his receipt stamped paid in full, and everybody rushed to the office. But unfortunately, it was too late. Of all the people in that organization, only one person was forgiven of what they owed. Why? Because they believed and acted on it. And so this morning I want to talk to us about the subject of unbelief. How do you conquer unbelief? It's amazing. Every day we hear a lot of things over the news, you know, with our friends, in the family. There's so much that goes on. There's so much information, especially in this day and age. There's so much information that we get. You know, what's the big story in Kenya right now? What's the big story in Kenya? Elections next year, March. That's the big story. Yeah, we hear a lot, but at the end of the day, you and I have a choice what we will believe and what we will not believe. And many of us are at a place where we are not really walking in the blessing of the Lord in our lives, not because the blessing is not there, but simply because we have not believed. We are like the guys outside the office chatting and asking ourselves, is it true? Will he really do it? Why is it taking so long? I think it's a trap. You go first and then me, I'll come after you. And so we are outside, yet we have been invited on the inside for accounts to be settled. And because we are in a state of unbelief, then nothing much is happening in our lives. I want us to take a look at a story in the Bible we all know so well. This is the story of Abraham and his wife Sarah and what they went through. Now, we refer to Abraham as the father of faith. But as we go through his story, you will realize that Abraham was not born the father of faith. His faith had to grow one step at a time, as much as yours and mine has to grow one step at a time. Genesis 18 from verse 10. Genesis 18 from verse 10 through to 15. And it says, one of the guests was the Lord, and he said, I'll come back about this time next year. And when I do, Sarah will already have a son. Sarah was behind Abraham, listening at the entrance to the tent. Abraham and Sarah were very old, and Sarah was well past the age of having children. So she laughed and said to herself, now that I am worn out and my husband is old, will I really know such happiness? The Lord asked Abraham, why did Sarah laugh? Does she doubt that she can have a child in her old age? I am the Lord. There's nothing too difficult for me. I'll come back next year at the time I promised, and Sarah will already have a son. Sarah was so frightened that she lied and said, I didn't laugh. Yes, you did, he answered. Now, we all know this story. We've read it over and over again from Sunday school until now. We still know it. And it's quite an amazing story when you really think about it. You know, many times we read the Bible stories and we read them as fairy tales. We don't really try to actualize them in real life and try to ask ourselves questions. Sometimes we read how, you know, Moses stood before the sea and it parted, and we think, hey, that dude was blessed. Imagine yourself standing before something like that, and God is telling you, you know, we assume God came down and Moses saw God. This is God, and God is saying, no. God was speaking to him the same way he speaks to us, in our spirits, in our hearts. And he had to stand in faith and do it. Same thing with Abraham. Here you have a guy who God tells one day, get up to a land that I will show you. Now picture today, your wife comes home from Jobo and she finds a truck and you're packing everything. And you're telling your wife, honey, we are moving. And she's asking, where to? And you say, actually, I don't know. I'm waiting for God to show us. Even if you're the senior pastor, your wife will ask you, what have you been smoking? Are you okay? You're taking us somewhere you don't know. That's the reality that Abraham had to face. That he gets up one day and he tells his wife, we are moving to another land and I don't know the directions. We'll have to go one day at a time. That's depending on God. That's believing that you had God and he knows what he is saying. And so the two of them embark on a journey. And as they begin that journey, God gives them a promise that his descendants will be many, that God will bless them. But the thing is, Abraham's wife is barren. I mean, isn't that just like God? To give you a barren wife and then to tell you, your descendants will be as many as the sand on the seashore. I'm thinking it would make more sense if God gives you a promise like that and you are somebody like who? Maybe a kukudenja? You know, a kukudenja had kids like nobody's business. If it's something like that, you can say, yeah, this promise makes sense. But God gives you a barren wife and a promise. And as we look at this story, I just want to give you 5 points. 5 points to show you how you can fight and believe. And point number one is this. Many times, read your Bible, God's favor comes as an impossible situation. God's favor always hides many times behind an impossible situation. I mean, God is a God of miracles. That's his speciality. What makes you think he'll make it easy for you? He has to bring an impossible situation such that when it comes to pass, everybody knows it's God. There's no doubt about it. It has to be God. How many of you have been praying and asking God, Lord, increase my faith? Am I the only one? Okay, you guys, you pray for what? Okay, Lord, increase my faith. Do you know that's a very dangerous prayer? It's very dangerous to pray a prayer like that, because what are you saying? When you say, God, increase my faith, think about Abraham, think about Job. You're basically telling God, bring trouble into my life so that I can stand in faith. You don't stand in faith when your rent is paid, do you? You don't stand in faith when school fees is paid, do you? You stand in faith when the landlord is knocking at your door. And you're almost tempted to shout, Hakuna mtu. That's when you stand in faith. So if you are praying, Lord, increase my faith, think again. Are you ready for that? Abraham and Sarah. Sarah is 90. Abraham is 100. 90. God gave this promise to Abraham when he was 75. It's been 25 years. No child. And you've been believing God that for what? For how many weeks? And you're complaining. 2 weeks. My friend, Abraham waited for 25 years. That earned him the title the father of faith. It doesn't come easy. God didn't say it would be easy. He just said it's possible. All things are possible to them that. I don't know what it is you're believing the Lord for, and what kind of an impossible situation God has brought in your life. So what are you doing? Are you lamenting and saying how God has forgotten you? Looking at the neighbors and how they're doing well. It's a very difficult place to be in. Very difficult. You know, there are times when I'm doing my program in the morning, people send in SMSs for prayer. And I pray for them. And sometimes, even before I finish my show, they send another SMS to say God has answered. Sometimes in the studio, I'm thinking, God, that's not a good joke. I've been praying for like 3 months. You've not sorted me out. Then I pray for somebody and you sort them out in one day. It's not fair. It's not fair. But hey, he is God. He knows where he is taking me. He knows what he is doing. So look at the impossible situations in your life and ask yourself, how do you react to those situations? Do you see them as an opportunity for God to perform a miracle? Or do you see them as opportunities to show you that God has forgotten all about you? God doesn't love me. I don't feel God anymore. How many of us can say we have some impossible situations in our lives currently? You need to look at that as an opportunity for God to come through for you. When the landlord is knocking and you have no rent, that's the time to smile and say, God, I can't wait to see how you will sort this one out. I can't wait to see, because I know you will sort it out. And many times he will sort it out in the way that you do not like. I remember a time I was living in Waidhaka. My rent was about 2,500. I couldn't afford rent. Living in a Kamabati house. God wanted to move me to another level. And for him to move me to another level, I had to be kicked out of that house. There was no other way. Because in my mind, there's no way I was going to move. Because I'm looking at the finances I have, and I'm thinking, if I can't afford a house of 2.5, what's the logical thing to do? To look for a house for 2K or even 1,500. If I can get one for a K, I'm blessed. Isn't it? That makes sense, doesn't it? Yet God wants to move me to a house of 5K. But I have mental blockage. And so what he does is, he allows the situation to go from bad to worse. From the frying pan, deep into the fire. And I am kicked out of the house with the most beautiful woman in the world. And I'm thinking, what? I've messed up this girl's life. But the same day I was kicked out, it's the same day he came through for me. It's the same day he moved me to a bigger house. So God may not necessarily provide what you're thinking he will provide in the way that you think he will provide it. He may come in another way. So point number one is that, remember, that God's favor and blessings many times hide themselves in an impossible situation. Abraham and Sarah learned that the hard way. Genesis 18:10 says this, I'll come back next year at the time I promised, and Sarah will already have a son. I will come back next year at the time I promised, and Sarah will already have a son. Point number two I want to make this morning is this. God will speak into your impossible situations. He will speak. He will. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing the word of God. God will not tell it to you once. He will tell it to you several times through people around you. But many times we ignore that voice. Many times we ignore that voice. Genesis 12, 1 and 2, the Lord said to Abraham, leave your country, your family, and your relatives. Go to the land I will show you. I will bless you and make your descendants into a great nation. You will become famous and be a blessing to others. That's where it began. But if you go on in the story, you find places where God comes back to reassure Abraham that the promise is still intact. It is still intact. It is still in place. I don't know about you. Personally, I have things I'm believing God for. Big things. Because my God is a big God. And I'm a big guy. So I'm believing God for big things. I have big dreams. And you know, sometimes I get to that place where I am so discouraged. I'm thinking, God, when? When? I'm getting old. Chance akutokea na tundevu tu white. Do something. Do something today. Do something now. But you know, I meet people who do not know me. I meet people who don't know what I'm going through. And they say something that reminds me that the promise of God is still intact. It is still intact. You know, when God moved us from that house of 2-5 to the house of 5, the amazing thing was this. We had checked out that house. And we thought, wow, this is like now our dream house. One bedroomed house. This is our dream house. One day we will live in a house like this. We had seen it. We had gone, checked it out. But we thought, aye, the Premier League, maze. Sisi tukoligindo? Tukoligindogo. But then all the other houses we looked at, we could not find something that fell within the range of cash that we had. The only house we found, we did find a house for 1K. Okay, it was more like a store. It was tiny. It was so tiny, it had like a small living room, a very tiny bedroom. You know, the kind that the door has to open from the outside because only a bed can fit in. As in, you open the door and you jump on the bed. The kitchen was so tiny, me and my wife could not fit in it. And don't look at me like that and say, it's because of your size. It was tiny. And we looked for that 1K and we could not find it. And do you know, the day before we were thrown out of the house, somebody in church approached my wife and said, I had a dream. I dreamt about you. You were coming out of this house. And this is how the house looked like. And she described that house of 5K. I mean, she described the color, where the windows were, and the flowers that were outside. I mean, she described it to the T. And we thought, what? And you know, the next day we were in that house. God will always remind you of His promise if you are careful to listen. Somebody will come to you and say something, but many times we are not sensitive to hold on to that word. God came to Abraham to remind him, is anything too hard for the Lord? You will be the father of nations. I don't know what God is trying to remind you. I don't know if you're holding on to that word. It's amazing. Many people tell me the same thing, and for me that keeps me going. Because of the things that I'm believing the Lord for. People send me SMSs, I meet people in the street and they say, you're the one on Hope FM. And they say the same thing. It's like they had a conference and they decided when you meet Jemo, this is what you say to him. It's amazing. And so I still wait. I still hold on. Because God reminds me every week, every other week, through different people. Sometimes you walk into the studio I know many of you think I have a very nice job. It's nice, but it's not as easy as you think. Because there are days you walk into the studio and you are the one who needs ministry. And you have millions of people expecting you to minister to them, to have answers to all their problems. And you're there and you're thinking, God, how will I do it today? Then out of the blue, one person either calls or sends you an SMS. And they give you a word. And it reminds you of why you are there. What is God telling you about what you are believing Him for? Maybe you're believing God for a car, a particular kind of car. And every time it passes, somebody tells you, hey, you would look nice in a car like that. Don't take that lightly. That is a reminder. That is a reminder. Or you visit somebody and they live in a nice house and you believe in God for a house. You've been believing like forever. And they tell you, don't worry, even you one day, if these things are here, these houses are here for us to live in them. Even you one day, you will live in a house like this. That's not just words. Hold on to that promise. Hold on to it. It may take 25 years or more, like Abraham, but it will come to pass. It will come to, so hold on to it. The third point I want to make to us today is this, that even as that word comes forth and you hold on to it, you have to believe that God is able to do the impossible. You have to believe that God is able to do the impossible. Do you realize, as much as we serve one God, we don't really have the same perspective of this God? Do you know that? I'm thinking about the children of Israel and David and Goliath. They were the children of God, Israel. But only one individual, a teenager, saw God bigger than Goliath. Do you believe that God will do it for you? Do you believe that God can do it for you? Do you believe that God can do it for you? Okay, that's like 15 people. Let's keep pushing. Do you believe that God can do it for you? When you read the story of Abraham and Sarah, you will realize that Abraham did not believe. As much as he is the father of faith, he did not believe. If you read earlier on, when God came and made the covenant of circumcision with him and changed his name from Abram to Abraham and his wife's name from Sarai to Sarah, Abraham laughed. We all say Sarah laughed. True. But before Sarah laughed, Abraham laughed. In fact, it says he laughed and fell down. Check your Bible. He laughed and fell down when God was reassuring him of the promise. And he said, God, just allow my other son, this son that I have from the Egyptian maidservant, allow him to be my heir. And God said, no, he is not the son of promise. You see, Isaac was not Abraham's firstborn child. He was the second. There was another child. And when Sarah laughed, God said, is there anything too hard for me? And that's a question I want to ask you today. Is there anything too hard for the God you serve? What do you believe the Lord can do? What do you believe the Lord can do? Do you believe the Lord can give you your dream job without any qualifications? Do you? He gave me my dream job without qualifications. I have no qualifications to be in radio. None whatsoever. None. N-O-N-E, none. I did not even go for a book an interview for myself. Mm-mm. How I landed in radio is when I moved into that house of 5K, and that's why God wanted me there. My neighbor used to help us out once in a while because we were still broke, eh? When God moved us into the house for 5K, He provided rent for the first 2 months. After that, we went back to our old patterns of landlord amekam zimata. And our neighbor used to sort us out. And one day, She got tired of sorting us out. Back in those days, family was the only Christian station, Christian radio station. And she walked into my house one day and she tells me, "You have an interview tomorrow." And I'm thinking, "Interview for what?" And she says, "Have you heard the new Christian radio?" And I tell her, "No." She tells me, "Put on the radio, 105.2. Family began as 105.2. And so we listened to it and she says, "Yes, you have an interview there tomorrow. Be there 9 o'clock in the morning." "An interview for what job?" "Radio presenter." And I'm thinking, "Woman, are you crazy? I'm a graphic designer." That's what I did in college. "I am a graphic designer, not a radio presenter." But anyway, when you're broke and you need money, you don't ask many questions. So I showed up. I showed up the next day, 9 on the dot. And then Dosi called me in his office and he asked me questions that I'm thinking, okay, where are we going with this? It never hit me until late last year what he was looking for. Because he asked me, "So what's your name?" I said my name. "Do you have a wife?" "Yes, I have." "Any kids?" "Yes, one son." "What do you like doing?" So we talked for about 15 minutes. Last question, "Do you want a job here?" And I'm looking at him and I'm thinking, "You think I came here to do what?" "Came here because I want that job." He says, "Fine, let me take you to the studio." And he takes me to the studio and he says, "This is our latest employee, show him the ropes." And I'm thinking, "Are you for real?" He didn't even ask me for my papers. Okay, my ID, at least to prove I'm Kenyan. Nothing. And that's how I ended up in radio. And it hit me last year, all the questions he was asking, he was listening to my voice. Is it a good radio voice? Are you confident in how you articulate yourself? Do you have your thoughts together? Are you believable? And so I got the job. Did the job for 8 months, left it, went into full-time ministry as a pastor. Same thing happened at Hope. I did not apply. I did not go looking for them. God wanted me back. They called me. Called me, went for an interview. They gave me the job. So God can do the impossible. But do you believe? Do you believe? You see, there was this Christian who was in a communist country. And you know, in communist countries, you can't be a Christian. You can't openly declare that you are a Christian. Find you with a Bible, you're in big problems. And so he was caught by the secret police and he was put in jail. And so the next day, they take him and they want to interrogate him. And they put him in this room and they have a Bible on the table and it's open to the book of Mark. And they ask him, "Do you believe that this is the word of God?" And he says yes. He says yes. And they give him a scripture to read in the book of Mark. And it's that scripture that says that if they drink deadly poisons, they will not be harmed. And he reads it. And they ask him, "Do you believe that scripture is true?" And he says, "Yes, I believe that scripture is true." And they say, "Fine, let's put it to the test." And they have a glass, they put water in it, and they add poison to it. And they tell him, just to prove to you that we are not bluffing, they bring in a dog, a huge dog. And it licks some of that water, and in 5 minutes flat, the dog is dead. And they ask him again, "Do you believe this is the word of God?" And he says, "Yes, I do believe." "Do you believe this scripture that you've just read?" "Yes, I believe." "Okay, have a glass of water." "Would you drink that water?" Don't be quick to say yes. Do not be quick to say yes. I want you to think about it. Would you drink that water? Or will you say, "Okay, there are places I'm struggling to believe. That I believe John 3:16. Now, ask me about John 3:16. That one I believe." And the gentleman said, "Can I pray before I drink the water?" And they told him, "Yes, you can pray." And he knelt down on his knees and he prayed. He prayed for these two men, that they would find God, that God would open up their eyes to the truth. He prayed for his wife and his children, that should he die, God would sustain them, God would provide for them, God would shield them. He said, "God, you know what? I'm not afraid of dying, because if I die, I'm coming home to be with you. And I believe your word is true. And if you choose to save me, fine. If you choose not to save me, it doesn't bother me." And he drank the water and he sat. 5 minutes passed, 10 minutes, 15 minutes. And these guys are wondering, okay, he's not dying. They call in a doctor to check him out. The doctor checks him out. Half an hour later, the guy is still breathing. He's okay. And guess what? They all believed. What do you believe your God can do? What do you believe your God can do? Do you believe your God can sort out your troubles? Saying and believing are two different things. Saying and believing are two different things. We say a lot of things, but what do you really believe? It is not what you say, it is what you believe. Because what you believe determines how you behave. The guy believed and he drank the water that was poisoned because he believed. Look at how you behave. Look at how you react to situations. That will tell you really what you believe in your heart. 12 disciples in one boat in the middle of a storm. They see a man walking on water. Only one guy says, Lord, if it is you, beckon me to come. Jesus says one word. He says, come. Without thinking, Peter jumps into the water. Peter walks on water. Of the 12, only one believed. I wonder how many of us in this church today would jump into the water if Jesus said, come. Come. Would you believe to that point of jumping out in the water? Or you will say, okay, let me fast. Hey, Lord, I'm sinking. Would you believe? You have to believe that your God is able to do the impossible, because that is what your God has specialized in. Lesson number 4 is this. Activating his powerful favor in your life requires unreasonable obedience. Unreasonable obedience. Think about Abraham and Sarah. It's 25 years later, no child. Now, Isaac was not going to be born the way Jesus was born, at your virgin birth. Stuff needed to happen. Some of you are slow. You'll catch that on the way home in number 3. The stuff that needed to happen. Yeah? Now, Sarah says, now that I'm old and worn out, will I find happiness? Even her, she knows she's worn out. I mean, things are sagging all over the place. That's the reality. Yet God is telling them, one more time. One more time. There's a baby that needs to be born. So you guys, one more time. They've done this dozens of times, but no baby had come forth. And now God is saying one more time, and they are old and withered. Come on, God. Obedience. Think about the disciples fishing the whole night. Fishing the whole night. They have not caught anything. And then Jesus, a carpenter, he's not even a fisherman. These guys have been fishermen their whole lives. And here you have a carpenter telling them, dudes, do this, cast your nets on the other side of the boat. And I'm thinking, Jesus, Kwani, how wide is a boat? If the fish are not on this side, you think they can be on this side? But what did they do? They obeyed. And they caught so much fish, they had to call other people to help them to haul it in. You see, many times we miss on the blessing of God because he tells us to do something that we have been doing one more time. Send that application one more time. Just send it. Send it this week. I know you have sent like 500 applications. It's okay. Send another one tomorrow. One more time, doing the same thing. It can get tiring. You've tried, you've tried, you've tried, and it's not working. And God tells you to do it one more time. That's the kind of obedience that he needs from us. You think it was easy for Sarah and Abraham? One more time? Lord, we've tried this all our lives, and there's no child that has ever come. And now we are old. Number one, it's biologically impossible, even for my wife to have a kid. She can die, but God says one more time. And because they obeyed, and a son came forth, Abraham is referred to as the father of faith. Are you willing to try it one more time? Are you willing to obey God one more time? Are you willing to? Samson, his hair has been cut, he's lost his strength, but his hair began to grow again, the Bible says. And he said, God, strengthen me one more time. And it says, in his death, he killed more than when he was alive. What is God asking you to do one more time? But you are reasoning and telling God, I've tried. God, I have tried. And you know I have tried. I have been hurt enough times. You've been in relationship after relationship. And you've been hurt enough times. And God is saying, I have somebody for you one more time. And you're thinking, no way, no way. I am done with this relationship's business. Yeah, I just want to serve you the rest of my life. I don't need somebody to come and sort me out and mess me up. Are you willing to do it for God one more time? Lastly, God will do impossible things when they are in his will. God will do impossible things when they are in his will. That's why we pray, not my will, but your will be done. You see, God was to be known as the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He was not to be known as the God of Abraham, Ishmael, and somebody else. That was not in the plan of God. So it didn't matter whether Sarah was 95 or 195. It didn't matter whether she had a womb or she didn't have a womb. It did not matter. The child would come. Because it was in the will of God. It didn't matter that there was a sea. The children of Israel had to cross. And so God made an impossible situation possible. It did not matter that the walls of Jericho were impenetrable. It didn't matter. And look at all the strategies that God gives us, or gives his children in the world. They're crazy things. Go around the wall one time every day. The seventh day, go around seven times. And then after you finish, you just shout. Okay. And then after we shout, see, if we shout, they'll come out and start killing us. You just do what you're told. And they go day one, they shout. They walk around day two, day three, day four, day five, day six, day seven. I'm sure by day three, the guys in Jericho were laughing and thinking, these dudes are crazy. What are they up to? And then day seven, they go around seven times, and then they shout, and the walls start shaking. Why? Because it was in the will of God. It was in the will of God for Goliath to come down. It didn't matter what kind of stone David used. It did not matter. As long as David obeyed, Goliath was coming down. There was no way he was going to miss. Why? It was in the will of God. Period. There's something that God has laid in store for you. It is in his will. But you have to do something. Whether it is going around the walls, you have to go around the walls. Whether it is lifting the staff for the waters to part, you have to do something. Whether it is slinging a stone, you have to do something. You have to do something. There's a part you need to play. Bible says without faith it's impossible to please God. It also says faith without works is dead. Many times we say we are standing in faith. How many of you have ever said, I'm standing in faith? There's no activity in standing. You walk by faith. Walk. You're headed somewhere. It may be somewhere you have no idea, like Abraham, but you are walking in a particular direction that God is guiding you. So I don't know what you are believing the Lord for. I don't know what is the struggle in your heart as you ask God, when God, when? When will you come through for me in this situation? I don't know what is going through your mind. But you need to believe that he is able. You need to believe that it is in his will. And as long as it is in his will, he will move mountains to make it come to pass. If you stand in faith and believe. Look at all the great heroes in the Bible. All of them had an impossible situation that they conquered in faith. Whether you talk about Abraham, whether you talk about David, whether you talk about Samson, whether you talk about Ruth and Naomi, they had impossible situations. And they had to stand in faith and to walk in faith and to believe. And God came through for them. So don't give up on God. Because God hasn't given up on you yet. He is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that you could ask, think, or imagine. The more complicated your life is, the more you should rejoice. Because God is setting you up for a major miracle. He is. He is. If the children of Israel had crossed a stream, do you think it would be in the Bible? Would you be inspired? That they left Egypt and they came across a stream, and they crossed it and they sang songs of jubilation. Would that inspire you? Anybody can cross a stream. Come on, give me a break. God says, stream. No. Let's give them a sea. A sea. Let's make things even worse. Let's tell the Egyptians, go after them. So here you have a sea. Here you have Egyptians coming on horseback. And then God says, let's make it more interesting. Pillar of fire, go between them. And the whole night there's a pillar of fire between the Israelites and the Egyptians. Now the Egyptians were crazy. Me, if I'm seeing a pillar of fire, I'm going back home. God is fighting for them, I am going back home. But they persist. Okay. The sea has parted and they are crossing. There's no way I'm going into that sea. Because if God had brought a pillar of fire to separate us from them, after they cross, you think God will hold the waters for us to go after them? I mean, how daft can you be? God will do crazy things for his children. He is a God who loves us unconditionally. And if you are walking in his will, he will move mountains to get you where you need to be. He will. Let me tell you, he will. That's what makes him tick. And he wants to do it for you. But you have to believe. If you read the New Testament, there are places that Jesus was not able to perform miracles. Not because there was a blackout and power was not flowing in him. It's simply because the people did not believe. You want to do great things for God? Believe that he is able and act on it and begin to do impossible things because it's possible. Come on, everybody! He lives! Come on! Put your hands!